One of the most interesting religious-themed films I've seen is titled Catholics, which is also known by a series of other names, such as The Conflict or A Fable of the Future. Released in 1971 as a television drama and directed by the Irish director Jack Gold, it tells the story of an ideological rift within the Catholic Church. A group of monks living in a monastery on an island off the coast of Ireland begin celebrating the traditional Latin Mass regularly in public. Over time, many of the locals begin to attend these Masses, and as word spreads, more and more people begin to attend. Eventually, a local television crew records and airs their Masses, which brings international attention to this group of monks and therefore increases the number of people attending their religious services. This inevitably causes a backlash within the Vatican. The film is set in what was then considered the distant future, in the aftermath of a new ecumenical council which implemented radical changes, including denying transubstantiation, bringing about radical liturgical changes, and insisting that the clergy only wear their proper liturgical vestments during the Mass itself. Because of these changes, the head of the religious order that the monks belonged to sent a young, ideological priest named Father Kinsella to the island to negotiate with the monks, with the intention of persuading them to cease saying the traditional Latin Mass. At the end of his stay at the monastery, Father Kinsella eventually orders the abbot of the monastery to stop saying the Latin Mass. The film then focuses in on the abbot as he struggles with his attempt to, on the one hand, stay true to the vow of obedience he took when he became a monk, and on the other hand, to maintain his strong adherence to the traditional practices of the church. Something which proves difficult since, in this particular scenario, these two things conflict. Things are made worse with Father Kinsella, the representative of his order's head, putting pressure on him on the one hand, and on the other hand, his fellow monks putting pressure on him in the opposite direction. If he disobeys Father Kinsella, there will be major canonical or ecclesial consequences. On the other hand, many of his fellow monks, who the abbot was given the authority to lead and care for, are angry and disappointed at him for abandoning what they see as the perpetual, God-given tradition of the church. Not only do the monks resort to holding organized protests in response to Father Kinsella's decision, but many of the monks begin to have their very faith shaken, which results in them facing an existential crisis. This moral dilemma, the movie goes on to show, is a playing out of a more personal moral dilemma that the abbot has been dealing with for years, namely his own crisis of faith that he has been dealing with silently for most of his time as a monk. The movie ends on somewhat of a cliffhanger. After Father Kinsella finally makes his decision, the abbot brings his fellow monks into the monastery to pray. As the other monks pray, the abbot becomes visibly disturbed, as he has a difficult time mustering up the faith to pray sincerely. And then it just ends. Why I find this film interesting is because it hits the nail right on the head with regard to many of the stereotypes within the church that have existed since the time of the Second Vatican Council. Father Kinsella represented the younger generation of priests who were ordained in the 1960s and 1970s. Many of them entered into adulthood and into the seminary during or immediately after the Second Vatican Council. They thus entered into their priestly formation at a time in which the secular culture, on the one hand, was promoting revolution, and the church, on the other hand, was experiencing massive internal change, particularly in terms of worship and in terms of how it expressed its traditional doctrines. Many at that time saw these two things as going hand in hand, as two sides of the same coin, revolution in the church and revolution in society. Many priests from that generation were the priests who would very often be found dressed in normal, everyday clothing when not in church. Many of them endorsed radical ideologies, such as liberation theology and some of the more extreme forms of ecumenism, and often saw the church more as a means of social uplift rather than as an institution that is fundamentally spiritual or religious in nature.
I suppose I'm the missionary type myself. I've always wanted to go to South America.
To be one of Father Hartman's revolutionaries overthrowing the government?
You've heard.
It's Father Gustav Hartman, a fine man.
He is. He was my teacher.
In South America?
No, I studied with him in Boston.
I should like to meet him. What sort of thing does he teach in those classes of his?
Well, he believes that the church is now the perfect structure through which social revolution can be brought to certain underdeveloped areas of the world, and he shows how it can be done.
Tell me, does he talk much about God?
In what way do you mean?
Oh, I don't know. Forget it.
No, go on, please.
Well, what I mean is it souls he's after, or is it the good of mankind?
Say the second.
I gathered as much.
Tell me, is it true? In South America, some priests are overthrowing the government.
Yes, they are.
How can they be doing the likes of that?
Why not? The early Christians were revolutionaries, remember?
What has that got to do with saving souls for God?
Everything. Do you know that in places like South America, young priests our age are dying for the causes of social justice?
But what are they doing being priests? You know, if I wanted to join the IRA, I'd have joined the IRA. But I joined the church.
So the church can be a powerful instrument of change. It can lead a revolution that people will follow. We have enormous influence.
You know, that's tripe. Look at the people over there on the mainland. They don't want your social justice. They want the old mass. They want to believe in something. Something more than this world can offer them. And what do you offer, Father?
Well, perhaps a better life, Father, not pie in the sky.
Yet clergy and theologians like Father Kinsella are, at the end of the day, ideologically driven rather than politically driven. Priests of the generation that came of age during or after the council didn't actually study theology in depth until after the council. When studying theology in a college or seminary context, they were taught that the way in which Catholic theology was being expressed at that time was the new paradigm, through which everything else had to be analyzed. The dominant attitude was, forget about everything that the church said or did prior to 1960. That was never what was officially taught by the council, but that was oftentimes how the council was misinterpreted. This was just the way they were taught, what they were taught to believe and say as priests and theologians. Yet the superior general of the religious order, of which Father Kinsella and the monks are members, represents a certain segment of the clergy who were running the church during and before the council. Such individuals had been promoting a more liberal theological agenda for decades prior to the council, but were often looked on with suspicion, and in Catholic academic circles were often marginalized. Yet once Vatican II occurred, many misinterpreted the council in order to promote their own agenda. Liberals of this type were not only ideologically motivated, but politically motivated as well. The monks on the island, on the other hand, represent many of the more conservative reactionaries who lived in the immediate aftermath of Vatican II. If you remember from roughly this time last year, when I published a series of videos on Traditionis Custodes, I explained how in the immediate aftermath of the Second Vatican Council, there were strict regulations on the pre-Vatican II liturgy. Thus, prior to Pope St. John Paul II and Pope Benedict XVI loosening these regulations, many more conservative Catholics usually fell into one of two categories. Either they attended the post-Vatican II liturgy, in spite of the fact that they took serious issue with it, or they left the church, to join or form radical splinter groups who verged on fundamentalism. The thing is, there were many individuals and groups within the church at the time in which this film was released who fell into one of these three categories: radical ideologues, churchmen with an agenda, or reactionaries. And what I find amazing is two things. Firstly, this film was released only a few years after the council, when both the immediate and long-term impacts of the council were just beginning to unfold. And yet, this film accurately describes what was at stake during and after the council. It did a really good job at really explaining the dynamics between these three groups of people within the church. Secondly, this film hits a bullseye in terms of summarizing the psychological mindset of a lot of Catholics at that time. The vast majority of Catholics were not radical liberals, nor were they scandalized by the council and eventually felt the urge to join some fringe traditionalist group. Yet, there were enough people at that time who did usually fall into one of those two categories. And the reason why there was so much controversy was because many people who are old enough to remember Vatican II and its immediate aftermath usually spent part or even most of their life growing up in the church prior to the council. They were raised with a particular expression of the Catholic faith, very different than the one we see today. There was a certain amount of cognitive dissonance involved. They were told by the clergy that the church believed one thing, but were now being told that they were obliged to believe in something different. The very same people they trusted to lead them closer to Jesus and to help the church, the means by which the Word of God and the sacraments are preserved, were now doing things that many people believed were harmful to our salvation and to the good of the church. Now again, not everyone interpreted Vatican II in light of this radical liberal stance, but there were enough people in the church who were doing so that there was a certain contingent of the Catholic Church that felt scandalized. How does one, in that context, square their duty to obey the church with their duty to adhere to the perennial tradition of the church? The reason why I bring this up is because prior to the 1980s, there were extremely strict regulations on the celebration of the pre-Vatican II liturgy. In fact, outside of a very specific, very few set of exceptions, the traditional Latin Mass was all but prohibited. It wasn't until Pope St. John Paul II and Pope Benedict XVI loosened the regulations on the traditional Latin Mass starting in the 1980s and 1990s, and later, in an even more radical way, with the 2007 document Summorum Pontificum, that it became possible to stay loyal to the mainstream church while also regularly attending the Latin Mass. In a word, you didn't have to join some fringe, schismatic, or borderline schismatic organization in order to get access to the traditional Latin Mass. Essentially, a lot of the moral dilemmas that more conservative or traditionalist Catholics felt back in the 1960s and 1970s were overcome. Yet many people, myself included, believe that any progress in this area has been undermined due to further restrictions on the traditional Latin Mass placed by Pope Francis in his July 2021 document Traditionis Custodes. Unfortunately, in the just a little over a year since Pope Francis published this document, further restrictions were placed on the traditional Latin Mass. On December 18, 2021, for example, the Congregation for Divine Worship, the main institution in the Vatican that regulates matters concerning the liturgy, published a document responding to some of the criticisms and questions surrounding Traditionis Custodes and its implementation. The introduction to the document affirms that the purpose of Traditionis Custodes was to preserve the liturgy from being used as an ideological weapon, which it often was in the larger debates between liberals and traditionalists in the church, and to create greater unity within the church, particularly of the Latin Rite. It reaffirmed that parish churches are not to be used for the celebration of the traditional Latin Mass, and that only churches, chapels, or other similar institutions established specifically by and for groups devoted to keeping the traditional Latin Mass are permitted to use the pre-Vatican II Latin Rite liturgy, and that parish churches or diocesan priests can only use the traditional Latin Mass if other places of worship are unavailable to do so, and even then, this can only take place if the local bishop has explicit permission from the Congregation for Divine Worship to allow this. The document also says that if a priest who celebrates the traditional Latin Mass refuses to concelebrate the new Mass, his privileges in celebrating the traditional Latin Mass are taken away, and many other similar regulations are stated. One of the strictest is that not only are there strict regulations on the Missale Romanum, the document that outlines how the Mass is to be said according to the pre-Vatican II rubrics, but also people are prohibited from using the Rituale Romanum and the Pontificale Romanum. The Rituale Romanum outlines how all of the other sacraments are to be celebrated according to the pre-Vatican II norms, and the Pontificale Romanum outlines the liturgical norms for religious ceremonies celebrated by bishops according to the pre-Vatican II liturgical texts. More specifically, this was aimed at limiting confirmations performed in the pre-Vatican II rites. Things haven't been much better on a local level. On July 22nd of this year, Cardinal Wilton Gregory, the Archbishop of Washington, D.C., passed a decree saying that St. Francis de Sales Parish in Washington, D.C. could no longer celebrate the traditional Latin Mass starting in September. This is in spite of the fact that St. Francis de Sales Parish is one of the oldest and most prominent parishes in the diocese, with some tracing its ongoing success to the fact that it frequently celebrates the traditional Latin Mass. Similarly, Cardinal Blaise Supich of the Archdiocese of Chicago said that as of August 1st, priests of the Institute of Christ the King and Sovereign Priest, a religious order dedicated to keeping alive the traditional Latin Mass, will no longer be allowed to celebrate the traditional Latin Mass in his diocese. This is in spite of the fact that the Institute is in full communion with the Catholic Church, a fact which is not disputed, unlike with groups like the Sedevacantists or the Society of St. Pius X, and in spite of the fact that traditionalist orders already approved by the Church can continue to celebrate the traditional Latin Mass according to Traditionis Custodes. In response to this, the famous, or in some circles infamous, Italian Archbishop Carlo Maria Vigano stated that this decision represents an attempt to, quote, prevent the exercise of a right that no ecclesial authority can take away, unquote. And further, this decision forces the, quote, acceptance of doctrinal and liturgical principles that are in blatant conflict with the immutable magisterium of the Church, unquote. On July 15th, the Diocese of Savannah in Georgia decreed that a Latin Mass that has been regularly said in the cathedral church of the diocese will no longer be celebrated after August 1st, and that Latin Masses will no longer be allowed throughout the diocese as of May of 2023. Many people are angry at this situation, and, in my opinion, rightfully so. As I said in my previous video on Traditionis Custodes, it is an imprudent decision to place burdensome restrictions or to even outright outlaw the pre-Vatican II version of the Latin Rite. It is an ancient and venerable rite that has spiritually nourished the faithful for the 19 and a half centuries prior to Vatican II. Those who believe that the church will benefit from the destruction of this traditional and spiritually beneficial form of worship often have a warped view of the church or the spiritual warfare that we find ourselves in. So, what are we to do? How are we to move forward? And that's where I need to be brutally honest. I'm not entirely sure. The church has traditionally held that the Pope is the highest authority in the church, with the authority to regulate the liturgical life of the church. Pope Pius XII wrote, in paragraph 58 of his 1947 encyclical Mediator Dei, that, quote, "the sovereign pontiff alone enjoys the right to recognize and establish any practice touching the worship of God, to introduce and to approve new rites, as also to modify those he judges to require modification," unquote. This does not, of course, mean that the Pope is free to change or suppress liturgical rubrics or to create new ones in an arbitrary or ad hoc manner. There are certain principles that govern the liturgical life of the Church which have been passed on since the time of Jesus and the Apostles, which, in turn, determine whether or not a sacrament is valid. There are limits to how much liturgical reform the Pope or a Council can bring about. But supposing that a Pope does not create a set of liturgical rubrics that go against these basic and immutable principles, and supposing that the Pope doesn't allow for exceptions to celebrate Mass differently, when the Pope issues a new set of liturgical rubrics, we are bound to go with the new way of celebrating the Mass. If one is not a traditionalist Catholic, or even if they are traditionalists, but just not of a rad trad sort, then they would have to admit that, from a purely canonical standpoint, neither the new Mass nor the old Mass are invalid. Traditionalists may choose to celebrate the pre-Vatican II liturgy, or even believe that the pre-Vatican II liturgy is superior to the post-Vatican II liturgy, but they cannot act as if the new Mass is invalid, or that it's not the normative form of worship in the Latin Church, until and unless a Pope comes around who abrogates the new Mass and re-establishes the Tridentine liturgy as the normative liturgy of the Church. Thus, for Catholics who aren't rad trads, we don't believe that Pope Francis, in suppressing the Latin Mass, has gotten rid of a valid liturgy and replaced it with an invalid one. Non-trads and moderate traditionalists do not believe that the new Mass is invalid, and they do not see any spiritual dangers inherent to the new Mass, when it is celebrated properly. Not only that, but because of this, it would appear to me that Pope Francis's decision is an example of him getting rid of one set of liturgical rubrics in favor of another equally valid one. And this is a canonically listed example of this precisely because, as I said before, both non-trads and most trads outside of the set of Vacantists believe that both forms of the Latin Rite are valid. Pope Francis's decision would be a licit example of his authority in liturgical matters. Pope Francis's decision would be invalid or illicit if he was using his authority to suppress the Latin Mass in favor of another invalid form of worship. But that's not the case here. Yet, even though this is the case, is it necessarily the most prudent decision for the clergy to outlaw the traditional Latin Mass? They may think it is. It seems as if the move to limit the traditional Latin Mass is, in part, motivated by criticisms of the traditionalist movement as such. Yet a lot of these seem to be stereotypes based on the beliefs or actions of certain schismatic rad trads. In this case, doing stuff that only further alienates the traditionalist movement is no different than punishing Eastern Catholics for the sin of schism on the part of Eastern Orthodox Christians, thinking that the schismatic tendencies of the Orthodox are endemic or inherent to all Eastern Christians, even those who submit to Rome. A lot of these criticisms are also based on a reaction to the toxic mindset of some members of the traditionalist movement. My reaction would be, don't degrade something good, the traditional Latin Mass, because of the fanatical or toxic elements of the traditionalist movement. Rather, find ways to reach such people, to change their minds and their hearts. Maybe we should be doing to the traditional Latin Mass crowd what a lot of people are attempting to do with the post-Vatican II crowd. For example, the Novus Ordo does not have to necessarily be celebrated like this.
Let us now together sing a song of glory.
We are Christians, we stand together as sons and daughters, redeemed and free. On the mountain and in the valleys, we praise you, Lord, for all to see. Sing Alleluia, your honor claim, obedience won.
Basically, a lot of people, even a lot of people who attend solely or primarily the New Mass, have woken up to the issues plaguing mainstream Catholicism since the 1960s. They have begun to see that ideological radicals have corrupted the texts of Vatican II, and therefore have a much more spiritually and intellectually nuanced approach to the situation, one that is, ironically, more rooted in tradition. But if the more moderate supporters of the church can create a distinction between the toxic supporters of the New Mass and the more moderate or more orthodox supporters of the New Mass, why can't we do the same thing with the traditionalists? In the New Mass crowd, people are more and more separating themselves from the mindset of the stereotypical hippy-dippy boomer liberal priest who sees the Mass as some sort of spiritual plaything. Likewise, traditionalists can and should separate themselves from the mindset of fanatics and schismatics. But don't throw out the baby with the bathwater. The modern traditionalist movement is, to some degree, a reactionary movement. There's inevitably going to be people in the traditionalist movement who take it too far. But in previous generations, when the Latin Mass was the norm, it produced saints. But just because in today's world, the traditional Latin Mass is situated within the context of a movement that, at times, can become extreme or even weird, that doesn't mean that the traditional Latin Mass itself is a bad thing. Rather, we need to change the minds and hearts of some of the people who attend the Latin Mass, rather than getting rid of the Latin Mass itself. Many bishops and cardinals have a narrow, short-sighted, and even ignorant view of things if they connect the Latin Mass more with the bad fruits produced by the traditionalist movement in the past 50 years, rather than the 2,000 years of saints, theologians, and mystics that it produced in the West. And again, there are some traditionalists who are schismatics or fanatics, but there are many more who were inspired by the traditional Latin Mass to live lives of holiness and devotion to Christ and His Church. Most traditionalists are not the crazy, holier-than-thou fanatics or schismatics that you sometimes see on the internet. Many traditionalist communities are bastions of orthodoxy, and that's why you see this old stereotype that Novus Ordo churches are on the decline while Latin Mass parishes are booming. Do the clergy really want to do away with the Latin Mass, with all of the beauty and potential to produce spiritual fruits? One could make the same argument about the new Mass as well, and I get it. But again, Catholics and Christians should have a certain amount of bias in favor of all things traditional. Considering how deeply rooted the traditional Latin Mass is in the history of the Latin Church, I believe that the Latin Rite Church should give a certain preference to something that has been producing saints for the past 2,000 years rather than something that has been producing saints for only 50 years. It would be like the Pope or a council suppressing the liturgy of St. John Chrysostom and then telling Eastern Catholics to get over it and calling them fanatics if they get upset. The liturgy of St. John Chrysostom and the other Eastern liturgies have been producing saints, mystics, and theologians for over 2,000 years in the Eastern Church. The same thing can be said about the traditional Latin Mass in the West. The thing is, there are 1.3 billion Catholics worldwide, and of whom I've seen some sources say that only about 16 million of them are Eastern Catholic. That's only about 1% of the total worldwide Catholic population. The agendas of liberal or heterodox clergymen are not undermined by a minority of Catholic communities remaining traditional, such as the Eastern Catholics. Yet, considering that the majority of Catholics are of the Latin Rite, if a good chunk of the members of the Latin Rite Church begin to head in a more traditional direction, that will begin to undermine the agenda of the more liberal or heterodox leaders of the church. However, for non-trads who may be sympathetic to the traditionalist movement, or more moderate traditionalists, the solution may not necessarily be the most clear-cut. People can do away with clown masses, and that will, in many ways, push back the agenda of liberal or heterodox clergymen. But the issue still remains. The Latin Mass would still be suppressed. It's not like we're living in a world where the church is imposing on us some invalid or spiritually bankrupt form of liturgy. The church creating the new Mass, say what you will about it on a practical level, was not an invalid or illicit expression of its authority in the liturgical realm. You may believe that the church shouldn't have revived the liturgy or the sacraments, or at least not in the manner or to the extent that they did, but you still don't believe, if you're a member of the FSSP or the IKSCP, that the new Mass is invalid or illicit, or else you wouldn't be in communion with a church where the vast majority of its members are celebrating an invalid Mass and have invalid clergy and invalid sacraments. It's not that something evil or something illicit has been imposed on us, but rather what we see is something that's probably equally as bad, the loss of something of great value. So the question still remains. For those who support the celebration of the traditional Latin Mass, how do we retain the Latin Mass and all of its spiritual fruits without falling into schism or disobedience? How do we avoid the moral or spiritual dilemma of the monks in the movie that I analyzed at the beginning of the video? And these are things that we should all be contemplating and trying to find answers to. Because at this point, this is a major development in the spiritual life of the church, one that may have large negative consequences. And it's for this reason that I implore all Catholics to study and especially to pray for the Holy Father and for the bishops. With this in mind, I'd like to thank you for joining me, and God bless.